When you think about landscape photography, you most likely also think about wide-angle lenses. But there are no direct relation between landscape photography and an optimal focal length. It all comes down to the scene you are photographing and your vision. The long focal lengths are just as important as the wider focal lengths are. In this video, I will share 5 steps on how to master the long lens for landscape photography. The first thing to understand is what a telezoom lens actually does. Like all other zoom lenses, all it does is zooming. It just does it at a longer focal length. It is that simple. A telezoom lens doesn't compress the world whatsoever, and it doesn't make distant objects look bigger. On the most basic level, it crops your field of view. The world around you, or specifically around the camera, is a 360-degree sphere, and the longer a focal length you use, the more you crop that sphere. That's it. This means if you use a long lens, you can really zoom into all those interesting details and make some beautiful abstract photos. I, however, rarely enjoy this kind of abstract nature photography. I just use the long lens for getting closer to whatever I'm taking a photo of. Sometimes the scene just demands that. In this one from the Faroes, the waterfall is on the other side of the fjord. If you are shooting with a wide angle here, you will have to include a lot of the surroundings, resulting in the waterfall looking smaller. If you want to show the scale of the waterfall, a long lens like the 70-200mm is preferable. In this photo from a sea stack in Iceland, I lined up the sun with the top of the sea stack. The scene required me to zoom to 105mm to get the photo. But as you can see, I left a lot of negative space above. If I wanted to get the sea stack even bigger, I would have to zoom in more. In this other example from the same sea stacks is one of my favorite photos from Iceland this winter. I finally got a sunset behind Reynistranga I've wanted for a very long time. Around winter solstice you can get this photo from within the town of Vik, but in February you have to get a few kilometers out of the town for the angle to be right. Being that much further from the sea stacks, I would have benefited from an even longer focal length than 200mm. A 100-400mm lens would have been better, as I had to crop this photo quite a lot. So cropping the scene is the same as zooming in, but when you digitally crop an image, you lose megapixels. That's why you want to crop it infield with the help of your lens. So you've probably heard the term compression in the context of telezoom lenses. You might even have heard people say a telezoom lens compresses the scene. As I said before, a telezoom or any other lens does not compress the scene whatsoever. By compression, I mean that effect where it seems like the background gets closer to the foreground. Obviously, this doesn't happen physically, and no lens are able to perform such magic. Compression is nothing more than an optical illusion, and it has more to do with your perspective relative to the foreground than the lens. Let me illustrate from an earlier video. Alright, so here's another great example of scale in landscape photography. So we have this massive glacier over here, Fjallsalon. And I have put Nigel just about here. And because of the distance between us, and I'm using a 200mm lens, I give the illusion of compressing the scene. So this massive glacier becomes huge compared to Nigel. And even so now, I could move like even way further back if it wasn't because of the hill. And I could make Nigel even smaller. But with this 200mm lens, you're moving back, you give the illusion of compressing the scene. Actually, you're not really compressing the scene. It's simply just the perspective that changes. Because the glacier is so big and Nigel is so small, so the distance between the camera and Nigel relative to the glacier becomes bigger, which means Nigel is moving closer to the glacier relative to me or the camera. And that gives the illusion of compressing the scene. Even though I'm not compressing anything, I'm only zooming in. So you can see here the difference between the 200 millimeter shot and the 70 millimeter shot is that I've zoomed in. I haven't changed the perspective or anything. I have more of the scene at 70 millimeter. So I'm not compressing by zooming in. I'm only zooming in. I'm cropping the picture. So you see now I'm only cropping. There is no kind of compression at all. Only zooming. Here's the final photos where me and Nigel switched position. If we compare to a wide angle photo of the same glacier, you can see it's two vastly different photos. In my opinion, the glacier looks kind of boring in the wide photo despite I have included all of it. The same thing goes for the video. I personally think that the zoomed in footage looks more dramatic than the 70mm footage. You can see the details of the glacier, and by not showing the top of the glacier, it seems it's taller than it really is. To conclude, moving away and zooming in is what creates this effect. Now that we understand the illusion of compression, which can be used in many different ways, it's on to step 3. This illusion or effect, if you will, is one I've become very fond of, as it can be used to really show the massive scale of nature. The thing to understand is there is a linear relation between the perceived size of an object and your distance from it. This means if you double your distance to an object, it will look half the size from your new perspective. And if you reduce the distance to an object by, let's say, 50%, the object will look twice as big. Here's an example from the Faroe Islands where I wanted a photo of this huge cliff in the background. As I wanted to show the scale, Thomas and I hiked up to a location here in the foreground, which is about 2.7 kilometers from the background cliff. As you can see from this footage, it makes no sense to use the wide angle lens here. I asked Thomas to stay and move back about 300 meters. A hill helped me get the perfect perspective. As you can see on this wide angle photo from that hill, it makes much more sense to zoom in. If I crop this photo, I can get the perspective I want and make the cliffs a bigger part of the photo. Despite being a fine photo in itself, it makes a huge difference when you add a person in there for scale, which I did with this photo. Using the optical illusion of compressing the scene by moving those 300 meters away, the distance between me and Thomas has effectively changed with a factor of 100, from 3 to 300 meters. But the distance between me and the cliff furthest away has only changed with about a factor of 1/10, from 2.7 kilometers to 3 kilometers. This means Thomas is 100 times smaller from this distance compared to if I was 3 meters from him, while the cliff in the background from my new perspective is only 90% of its size seen from Thomas's perspective. Having this big distance between the foreground and the camera makes a huge difference, which is easy to see if we compare to this photo. Here I used a wider focal length and I'm only about 30 meters from the camera. I still like the photo, but for showing scale and the grandeur of nature, the one with Thomas is much more effective. This effect can be used in many different locations and many different ways. It can also be achieved with a wider focal length, although it is often more pronounced with the longer focal length. These two photos from the Faroes are taken at more or less the same perspective. One at 24mm and one at 35mm. One from me and Sophie's tour to the Faroes in 2017, and one from a recent workshop I did with Nigel Danson, where one of our guests, Mark, wanted to pose for the scene. There are about 100 meters between these two perspectives, so the distance to the background mountains are about the same. If I give the photo with Sophie a slight crop as to line up the mountains, you can see how big a difference it makes when the foreground subject is further from the camera. I'm not saying this is better in regard to the final photo and what you want to show, but it does help to illustrate the scale of the area better. Also be aware that in all the examples I've shown in this video, all people posing in the foreground are perfectly safe and not close to any tall edges. Using this illusion or compression effect, you can create some epic photos where you really get to show some scale and drama without putting your foreground subjects in danger. How you use this effect is up to you and your imagination and vision. Settings is another issue you need to address and be aware of if you photograph with the longer focal lengths. The main thing to be aware of is your aperture. The longer a focal length you use, the narrower your depth of field becomes. At these long focal lengths, you will likely need a closed down aperture to get everything in focus. We can get into the entire math with hyperfocal distance and so on, but I usually just eyeball it. Upon reviewing it, I make sure both the foreground and background is in focus. If parts of the photo is out of focus, I have to adjust the aperture. Be careful not to make it too small as you start to introduce diffraction, which is an optical effect that makes your photo softer. I usually do not go beyond f16, and even there you might start to see some diffraction. If parts of your photo is still out of focus, you'll have to start a process of focus blending, and there are tons of videos about that for free here on YouTube. With a closed down aperture and ISO 100, the shutter speed might become longer than you can handhold. In such case, a tripod comes in handy. As always, if you shoot on a tripod, you'll likely benefit from turning off image stabilization. If you still get blurry photos, you might want to use either silent shooting in combination with a 2-second timer for mirrorless cameras or the mirror lock-up function for DSLRs. The mirror lock-up function locks the mirror for a short period before the camera takes the photo. This ought to remove any shake the mirror makes when you take the photo. You can also retract and spread out the legs of your tripod. This makes the tripod way more stable. The last step of the equation is to nail the composition. Think about what you're taking a photo of. In these examples, it is about the rock in the background. The rock is the main focal point, while Thomas is the secondary, which supports the main. In this photo, it is the waterfall which is the main focal point, and as with the previous photo, Thomas acts as a secondary focal point which supports the main focal point. Here's another photo from the same location but a little different perspective. Your eyes might either go to Mark posing on the rock first or the waterfall, but the lines in the water should potentially create a visual dynamic leading you towards the rock and Mark. After you've seen Mark in the waves, your eyes probably go on to the waterfall in the background, which should lead you to the water and then back to Mark. All these elements result in a circular visual flow. In this example, I am the focal point. I am the photographer taking a photo of the glacier. Having the glacier take up so much of the photo shows size and power, yet because of the high contrast, your eyes likely go to me first, making me the focal point. The story is the interaction between me and the glacier. In this example from the Witch's Finger, also in the Faroes, I'm photographing the cliff from another location than the regular one I show in my Faroe Islands series. In this photo, you get a way better idea of how absolutely massive this cliff is because you have this small house in the foreground. Even then, the house is still about right in the middle between the Witch's Finger and me, as the house is about 2.5 kilometers away from my position and the finger is about 5 kilometers away. I could crop the foreground out of this photo, but the point is not all about the scale. In this photo, I've just about caught all the elements that make the Faroe Islands unique. The sheep, the salmon farming, the hut in comparison to the massive cliffs and with the dabbled light that benefit the points of interest in the photo. A thing to take away from these photos are you cannot remove any of the focal points, neither the main nor the secondary, without drastically reducing the impact and story of the photos. Think about this when you compose your photos. Are any of the elements within the frame unnecessary, and what can you do to remove them? What's the point of adding a person to your photos, and what are you trying to show? Be sure to check out my 3 other videos on composition if you haven't already. Here I go deeper into compositional tools such as balance, leading lines, depth and so forth. The 70-200mm or the 100-400mm lens are essential part of the landscape photographer's toolkit. Here is a collection of some of my personal photographs I've taken with the longer focal lengths which I haven't shown in this video. We'll be right back. as I can observe on the views and the watch time on my past videos from the Faroe Islands, there seemed to be a saturation on videos from the Faroes. That bulk of videos from the Faroes are done now. So in the future, I will make more of videos like this one here, and I will make some time lapses and other kinds of videos. I will also talk about some of my favorite photos I've taken this winter, both in Iceland and in the Faroes. So we'll talk a bit more about settings and composition and my thoughts behind them. And I hope you look forward to that. And generally, I will just like mix up the videos a bit more. I also have some videos from Iceland coming out. So thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned something from this video, or at least got some of your information refreshed in regard to long lens photography. As always, I would highly appreciate both a like and a comment.